Today, in plants like this, the making of gold-filled material for jewelry and other manufacturers is a multi-million dollar business. It all starts with 24-karat pure gold. This ingot, worth thousands of dollars, is cut up to provide the proper percentage of gold for the customer's individual specifications. The mix, which is carefully weighed, contains a prescribed amount of other metals, such as copper, nickel, silver, or zinc, depending upon the color desired for the gold-filled material. Silver is mixed in to give a greenish or yellow tint. Copper gives the gold a pink or pinkish yellow glow. Nickel will bring out a whitish tint. The percentage for 12-karat gold, for instance, is 50% pure gold and 50% alloy. Here in the melting room, a skilled workman operates more by experience than the book. Approximately 15 minutes, depending upon the alloy, at 1900 degrees is what the book says. But it takes an educated instinct to know exactly when the mix is ready for pouring into a mold. If it heats too much, the karat gold will blister when it sets. Not enough heat will cause it to segregate. The karat gold bar is set. The bar next is fed through a rolling mill, which reduces it about 10% on each roll, gradually bringing it down to desired length and thickness for its primary stage. Meanwhile, similar bars are sent through an annealing process to soften the metal for additional rolling. Otherwise, the metal would become brittle. The alternating of rolling and annealing continues until the bar reaches proper thinness. Then the bar of karat gold is fitted to a slab of base metal the same length and width, and the quality mark, 12-karat gold, is punched into it. The gold is equal to 1/20th of the total weight of both pieces, federal government minimum standard for gold filled. It will remain that way right through the final shape or size of the finished metal. Next, we have the marriage of 12-karat gold and base metal. A bonding medium is placed between the metals, and a protective covering is added to guard against scorching. Somewhat like a metal sandwich, it goes into the bonding furnace, where under tons of pressure and intense heat, the gold becomes permanently bonded to the foundation metal. Just about done now. Now out through the cooling chamber and ready to take whatever shape is called for. Here it becomes flat stock, one of three basic shapes for the ultimate user. Brought down by a cold reduction operation to whatever thickness is desired, flat stock will result in a wide variety of gold-filled products. Cufflinks and tie clasps. Watch cases. Lighters. Belt buckles. A second gold-filled material is wire. It begins as discs cut out of the flat stock. The discs ultimately become shallow cups, which don't even look distantly related to a piece of wire. But after several stages of shaping, the tubes will be ready for conversion to slender and even gossamer-like strands. Since this is to be solid wire, the karat gold stock is slipped over a core of base metal to which it will be united by the intense heat of the bonding furnace. And now into the bonding furnace, a different shaped one than is used for flat stock. The solid cylinder next goes through a series of reducing operations until it eventually emerges a wire encircled by a continuous layer of carat gold. Yet even though a single cylinder can be drawn into hundreds and even thousands of feet, it will always retain the original proportion of carat gold to base metal. Thinner and thinner, until finally it can be coiled like so much rope or string. How fine can it get? Coming up is an inspection under a magnifying glass of wire only 1/100th of an inch thick. From fine wire like this can come such things as filigree watch attachments. Exquisite women's jewelry. These are earrings. Here a lovely necklace. Third major type of gold-filled stock is tubing. But here, unlike wire, where carat gold is bonded to base metal, the tubing itself is of gold-filled material. This is slipped over a removable steel rod and drawn to desired thickness. Each step of the way will stretch it longer and thinner over the removable rod. Tubing like this eventually may be used for the finest pen and pencil sets. Now, even though a combination of fine gold and alloy has come a long way from the gold room, the end products fashioned from it must still reflect a high degree of skill and imagination. Nearly everything made of gold-filled material, as in this first step in lighter cases, needs special tools to coax the metal into desired shape. For these cases, flat oval blanks are drawn many times and annealed each time before they become top and bottom sections of the lighter. Here are the various stages. The result, a fine gold-filled lighter. From gold-filled too comes some of the most exquisite women's and men's jewelry. Let's watch now as a lovely set of earrings comes into being, starting with fine gold-filled flat stock. The material is punched and pierced into the basic shape. Once the final shape is established, each piece is individually engraved to impart the overall pattern. In this case, a sunburst design is delicately scored into the metal with carefully timed strokes. Fine jewelry such as this, assembly by hand is virtually mandatory. Painstaking care and precision must be practiced at all times. Soldering the tiniest parts must be done by cautious and knowing hands. When the piece is completed, a rouged buffing wheel provides a fine high luster, the hallmark of all gold-filled finished products. Incidentally, gold-filled has an extremely high degree of resistance to tarnish and wear. Manufacturers who make gold-filled jewelry, such as cufflinks and tie clasps, place orders expressly for stock in any of the many carat gold shades. The processing of the basic material, therefore, means a tailor-made operation, and only the most highly skilled manufacturers are in this business. With such built-in quality control, it is small wonder that the end product manufacturer comes up with such rich variety and classic beauty. Now, one of the products of man's ingenuity is the watch, its complex mechanism enabling us to determine one of the most important factors of our lives, time. Important to the watch is the casing for the mechanism, not only for fashion, but protection. Turning out a watch case, there are dozens of operations before the case is ready for the movement. The precise engineering of watch cases requires tools which are machined to extremely close tolerances, so the delicate mechanism within the case is protected against shock, moisture, and dust. Not only must the tools be accurate, but hand operations, such as soldering, still reflect the traditional art of the watchmaker and the goldsmith. Here again, the malleability of gold filled is used to create a product of long-wearing, heirloom quality. A bath in a strong dissolving solution dramatically demonstrates the thickness of the actual carat gold surface of this gold-filled watch case. Dropped into the acid, the base metal to which the gold is bonded will completely dissolve. What is left is the carat gold layer, which is the protective wearing surface of the case. The expandable watch band you may be wearing might not seem too intricate, but it is composed of several hundred parts, all put together by hand. These are the top shells being stamped out of gold-filled flat stock. Tiny, tiny springs are individually inserted to give the band its stretch. After shells, liners, tubes, and springs are assembled, a final buffing adds to the rich gleam of gold. A band for every taste, style, as well as serviceability. A watch band for every type watch. Another large user of gold-filled material is the optical industry, where styling with gold-filled lends an exciting fashion note. Wire is the basic stock. Here it is being flattened for the temple pieces. Small hinge arms must be soldered individually to the temple butts. Gold filled, incidentally, has the advantage of providing great malleability, which assures proper overall fit. An important procedure is the truing of the frames. This must be done by craftsmen who know every last wisp of pressure they can apply in giving the frame its final form.